The game of cricket has a long history rich in legends, heroes and champions. One of the greatest bowlers ever to grace the game was Sydney Barnes. His career spanned over 50 seasons and he was even asked to play for England at the age of 48. And yet he was renowned for being an incredibly difficult and dour personality. He was the first and perhaps ultimate cricket professional, a challenger of authority and the establishment. And not the least, he was a genius bowler feared throughout the world of cricket, whose innovative approach and dedication brought him records at every level of the game.
He regarded cricket like you would regard any other job. Like if you were working in a factory, you would work from, you know, 9 till 5. You wouldn't work from 9 till 5 past 5. And he regarded cricket in a very, very similar light, which a lot of people found a bit unusual.
Sydney Barnes would have been quite at home in the present environment because he thought it was a great honour to play for England, but he also felt that he should have something in his pocket as well. And this was his own, what he thought about life and thought about cricket. Why should he play 6 days a week when he could play for a league, or a Lancashire league, or a Staffordshire league, and get the same amount of money or more by just working 2 or 3 days a week and playing on the Saturday? And of course he would have been at home because he was the first man to have a manager and a publicist. And the name of that manager and the name of that publicist was Sydney Barnes.
He was very much the enigma of the time and very much a product of his time. Don't forget, when Barnes first appeared in county cricket and on the international scene, 1901-2003, the nascent Independent Labour Party was just gaining votes, gaining a foothold in society in England. James Kerr Hardy, of course, was around at this time. Emily Pankhurst forming the Women's Social and Political Union. Barnes, in his own way, was a working class hero of that time. Just as in the football world, there was Billy Meredith playing for Manchester City and Manchester United, a great bribe scandal at the time. Barnes, in his own way, was asserting the values of the working class person in the sporting world, in a world that previously had been the preserve of the gentleman amateur.
Even at Lancashire, just to say this, that an actual member of the club could come down to have nets and summon one of the bowlers to bowl at him. Now, you know, you could have an England bowler there bowling at a member in the nets. For what reason? Because, you know, he was regarded as little more than a servant. And so that's the background you actually see Barnes in.
And so you still didn't get over this class distinction. Let's be honest about it, this class distinction. And of course, when you've got a man like Sydney Barnes, who actually had a mind and wished to use it and wished to better himself, they can understand it, never mind accept it.
In a lot of cases, a lot of these gentlemen were shamateurs. For example, Archie McLaren at Old Trafford was the assistant treasurer and was paid as much, if not more, than most of the professional players. W.G. Grace, the greatest shamateur of them all. Now, Barnes grew up during these, I know it's the end of Grace's career, but Archie McLaren was his captain at Lancashire, and he saw this all through the country, that these supposed gentlemen were being paid to play, and he couldn't see why. Why this wasn't just out in the open, why there was this differentiation between gentlemen and players.
Cricket perhaps could have moved faster in the age when Barnes played if more players had been like Barnes and actually stood up for what they believed in and also the gifts that they had. And the sadness is that cricket, certainly Test and County cricket, could actually lose somebody like Barnes so quickly when he was so great.
I went up to the committee room one day. I said, you can keep your winter pay. I'll work for it so that I've got something to look forward to when I finish cricket. And their reply was, oh, we can't be bothered finding your work. I said, all right. I said, it's up to me then. And that was the end of Lancashire.
Sydney Barnes married and started a family immediately, and he decided that the best method of securing their future was a return to league cricket. Thus, the 1903 season was his last on the county circuit, despite bowling in excess of 1,000 overs and taking 131 wickets at 17.85, helping Lancashire to fourth place in the county championship in the process.
At the end of that 1903 season, because Barnes was no longer contracted to Lancashire, because he decided to go back to league cricket, he was ignored by the test selectors.
Barnes left Lancashire amidst a storm of publicity, with Wisden describing his move to the Church Club as a
defection,
and the county's minutes recording that they were
finally disposing of Barnes.
In his two seasons at Church, he bowled a total of only 591 overs, and yet took 154 wickets at just 9.42 apiece. He quite simply terrorised the opposition.
I like the stories of, you know, the sort of opposing captains saying, you know, saying to number seven batsman, pad up, you know, right at the very beginning of the innings. And number seven saying, well, you know, why should I pad up? I'm number seven. You'll be needed quickly. And sure enough, you know, after half an hour, the number seven was in, because Barnes had taken five wickets. Marvellous.
For the 1906 season, Barnes returned home to North Staffordshire, where he played in the league for Port Hill Park in Stoke-on-Trent.
Well, at that time, I suppose in 1906, he must have been one of the finest professionals in the league. And he must have got a load of wickets in that time. And this is just one instance of it, where he went all through the league innings, you see. The match was played between Port Hill and Leigh Highfield on the 18th of August 1906, in which S.F. Barnes, Port Hill professional, batted all through the Port Hill innings, going in first, and then took all 10 Leigh Highfield wickets. In other words, Leigh Highfield were out for 37, Port Hill 136. He must have done other things, but he was an exceptional bowler compared with the other league bowlers at the time, you see. But that's probably one of the most exceptional, I suppose, really, to get all 10 wickets and get the high score in the Port Hill innings, you see.
Port Hill became the preeminent team in the league, with Barnes taking 100 wickets in a season six times at an incredible average of just 5.28 in his 9 years at the club. Somewhat ironically, at the same time, he was also making waves playing for Staffordshire in the Minor Counties Championship.
Staffordshire had not really had a great deal of success as minor county cricketers until the name Sydney Barnes was associated, and that changed Staffordshire's impact as well, because he actually, his performances with the ball meant that Staffordshire started becoming quite a good side, and very, very early on he actually was a main instigator in them winning the Minor Counties Championship, I think 3 years in succession.
He realised he was a good cricketer, and you couldn't take that away from him, could you? Now, he scored centuries for Staffordshire, you know, with the bat. Besides the 1,400 wickets, he scored quite a few centuries for Staffordshire.
If I'd been out for records, I could have made a lot more runs.
And for most of his time when he played for Port Hill, he actually was playing for either England or the MCC. For a club cricketer or a league cricketer to play for his club and then to go off in the summer and play for England, or maybe that winter go and tour South Africa or Australia. It's unbelievable.
People could not understand him. People couldn't work him out. They could neither work him out on the cricket field in terms of how he bowled to you, or how he would react in terms of whether he would want to play. And that's strange. He wasn't predictable in any shape or form. I think there is a sense in which he was predictable to his family, and I think he's kept his family life very much, you know, very much to himself. But certainly that sense of enigma, nobody could work him out.
In 1932, the touring Indian team visited Stoke to play Staffordshire. Barnes took five wickets for 85 in a drawn game, displaying all his old fire and guile. Even at nearly 60 years of age, Barnes played to win, a virtue recalled by cricket broadcaster John Arlott.
Still, batsmen feared him. Still, at an age when he could draw the old age pension, there was this tall, upright man bowling, and still, though not at his old great pace, still from time to time making the ball snarl up off the pitch against the fingers, still bowling that old leg break and the off cutter, still bowling an immaculate length, still bowling them out.
His obsessively competitive nature stayed with him as he continued to decimate opposing batting lineups in the Lancashire leagues. John Arlott recalls another story.
Two tail-end batsmen were nicking and edging him everywhere except where they were aiming, and he stumped off at the end of an over with the words, "They're not batting well enough to get out."
Between 1924 and 1933, Barnes averaged over 106 wickets per season at an unbelievable average of 6.8 in league cricket. As he wound down his career with hometown club Smethwick, his average was still under 10 in taking 113 wickets over two seasons at the ripe old age of 63. His career record in the league reads 4,069 wickets at 6.08, and with Staffordshire a further 1,441 victims costing 8.15 apiece. Phenomenal bowling.
The greatest bowler of them all, as many pundits might agree, a stern-faced titan with the ball, whose like we never more may see. So accomplished at his noble art, with fierce spin and deviations, he tore illustrious sides apart, laying bare their limitations.
I was very impressed. I enjoyed it very much indeed. It was something that I'd, you know, never experienced before, the theatre and the round business. I enjoyed it very much. Well, being in such close proximity was, you know, very exciting. I thought, you know, having only sat in what was the Theatre Royal before, you know, miles away from the stage, usually in the gods, you know, miles away from the action, I felt it was very, very interesting to be so close. Enjoyed it very much.
I've been to a theatre in the round before, but I thought this one, I think it's brilliant. I rave about it. I'm a Londoner and I've never seen anything like it. I think the actors are fantastic, the atmosphere in particular is marvellous. Because it's so unique, you never see anything. I've never seen anything done with so much enthusiasm, so much sincerity, if you like. And it's very informal. You could come here any time, any place, dressed in whatever you like, with whoever you like, and enjoy it.
This is the workshop. It's quite small, but being theatre in the round, we don't have massive sets with huge flats and that sort of thing. An advantage of it being small and only having that normal door to get out of is that it means we have to think about the size of everything, and everything that's made has to be able to be broken down into small units, which is good because when it gets down to the other end in the theatre, it makes it easier to handle, or relatively easy to handle. And our biggest problem is that every time we do a show, we make fresh things for it, and we've got to find space to store them.
After my degree, I won an Arts Council bursary, which was this subject I was touching on just now. I won an Arts Council bursary to come and work with Peter. I had no idea how fantastic that was going to be. Obviously, you all know about Peter's play policies and the kind of programme we were doing then of classical plays, a tremendous amount of new writing, children's work, and of course documentaries. And suddenly I found myself in a place where the work really mattered and there was a political edge, and it made sense to me. And I thought, now I know why I'm in theatre. I know what the job is. And I've from time to time gone to my father and said, look, should I really be doing this? This seems a very, very sort of selfish activity. I'm having such a wonderful time. Should I be being a theatre designer? Surely I should be in Rwanda. I should be helping people who haven't got any legs and trying to get people food who haven't got, you know, the much more important things to do than designing plays. And he always used to say to me, just remember you're helping people understand their lives. And that made me feel a lot better. And I think that's, I suppose, if I hope I've done anything, I hope with the work that I've done with all my colleagues, is, I mean, that's why we do it, isn't it? That's what art's about, that's what theatre's about, that's what theatre's for. Our subject is life, and with plays, we can start to look at our lives and hopefully understand them. I'm currently designing King Lear, and that's a toughie, if you think about those subjects. It was, of course, a theatre in the round. It is, I should say, a theatre in the round, Stoke-on-Trent. And I can now see, looking back, how the form of that theatre helped me develop a philosophy. Working in the round, I began to understand, I mean, this, you know, I have to say, this, so much of this is in retrospect. This isn't actually something, I didn't sit there, you know, bushy-tailed in 23 going, age 23 going, oh, you know, I suddenly understand the power of the performer in the space, you know. I wasn't doing that. I was actually just trying to get bloody thing to happen or whatever it was. But in retrospect, I can see that I was understanding about the power of the performer in the space, the power of the actor, the power of the objects that surround them, and how one actor has a relationship with the other and a power over that actor, and one object has a relationship with the other objects that are on the stage. And I began to realise, it was slightly driven by, it's lovely that the accountant from the theatre is here tonight, but it was, of course, this aesthetic where we had not very much in this, on the stage, in the space, was slightly driven by the fact that we had small budgets.
We've been making Ireland's sheltered bar since 1839, and through the years of war and strife we've stood the test of time. But now they want to turf us out and throw us with the scrap. They must be bloody balmy if they think we'll stand for that. We know we make a profit and we know our steel's the best. Men with money, brains and business sense are ready to invest. We get our orders out on time, we never get complaints. We're too bloody good to be alive, they ought to make us saints.
We calculated how much it would cost us to produce steel ourselves. We included the cost of new capital, electric arc furnaces and Shelton's price. The result was this. Scunthorpe steel, £44.98 per tonne. Shelton's steel, £37.05 per tonne. Ours was £8 cheaper.
They want to keep our Demag mill the finest in the land, and put the rest in mothballs just to keep it near at hand. But we have got another plan, I'm sure you will agree. Put the BSC in mothballs, then Shelton will be free. We're Shelton men, we're not afraid, we've got our dignity. We'll fight and win the battle, boys, against the BSC. They may be strong and powerful, but that won't get them far. For we are all united now to fight for Shelton Bar.
Stoke-on-Trent is now facing one of the greatest social and economic disasters this city has ever known.
May I say also how very conscious we are of the performance of the Shelton plant. The mill is one of the best in the country.
I remember, even during the preamble, I had a growing sense of doom, you know, because I knew what he was coming up to, the way he phrased his talk. Made me know we were going to get the chop.
What I think we must ask is whose estimates, where did they get their figures, and on what basis are these estimates arrived at?
It really is amazingly naive. Perhaps they feel we're too thick to appreciate some of the financial arguments, but words really do fail me. They've taken so many suppositions to suit their case.
Mind you, there are themes that are like British art. You get a strong sense in painting of an attachment to place and a feeling for place, a feeling for a particular place. And there's that on the one hand, and then there's the Hogarthian kind of caricature of a Hogarthian cartoon, which comes right up into an artist like Hockney. It's very strong, this kind of thing, in English art. But they are two quite different and separate themes within the English pictorial character. Sometimes they nearly marry in an artist, a smaller artist like Rowlands. You know, you get a touch of both of them.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have thought that we have ever had any painters that have had great influence upon Europe. I can say we have made a deal of Constable having an influence on Delacroix, but I don't think he was such a powerful influence as all that. I think that he was looked at and, you know, nodded to, but, you know, has got. I can't think of any English painter.
How do you come to be a painter anyway, Arthur?
Well, I don't know. I reckon that if I'd have, I reckon it's having this curious arm. If I hadn't, I should have been a bricklayer like my father. It's just one thing led into it, I suppose. It's something like that. I should have had to have gone to the war, and I should have certainly gone into my father's work and been a bricklayer. Just the same down the pit, a colliery bricklayer. It's just, well, those are the sort of accidents. You know, one thing happens and another thing happens. And certainly, I would never have been one otherwise. I wouldn't have thought so.
You went to the Royal College very early, didn't you?
Yeah, I was 17 when I went there. I'd done a lot of drawings of me. I used to draw me uncles and me street and me window frame and me the things of me life. If I, you know, I always begun with the end of the table, what I could see and what I knew. And I'd done a lot of these drawings in pen, and I used to draw them in pen and ink, and I'd done a lot of them, and the local art school, there were about half a dozen students, and they sent a collection of these drawings to London, and Professor Osborne, I think it was, he said, well, he'd come up and see me. I think he came up and see me and said to me, well, would I like to go to the Royal College? So I went, that's how I went to the Royal College, you see. I went when I was 17 when I went there. There was a lot of blokes in the war at the time, you know. A lot of chaps who were fighting in the war, and I mean, that's perhaps why the Royal College would take a 17-year-old boy at that time. I would have thought something like that was the reason. Then they began to come back after the war with their legs off, their arms off, and all sorts of things, little by little, filter back up to Ambleside and take up the brush again. That's what happened. Three years of some kind of, I remember them like a dream, like a paradise it was to me, and that time I can hardly think it ever happened to me. But it was a hermetic, a sealed off place when you thought what was happening in Europe, the hell and war in Europe, and at the Royal College of Art in a little place in Ambleside, we were all talking about Sir John Everett, Millais, and people of that kind. It was a very strange little pool of life that we were involved in. The others, the great European masters of the 20th century, as I understood them, were never mentioned. It was a most insular place, but an enjoyable and pleasant place. And I, you know, must say that although it was a disappointment in the way that I was expecting heroes and heroes to be worshipped, they were not heroes. They were, you know, moderate men, but serious men, and what they told me in the long run, I found, was a sensible and a good thing, but only sensible and good. And you know, when you're 20 and you're an artist or young, you really want something rather more than a sensible doctrine. You wanted, you know, you wanted heroes, and there were heroes. Europe was filled with masters. There were half a dozen, you know, just across 22 miles of continent. They had no change for them at the Royal College at that time. It's changed now completely, of course, and it had to, but it had, as like these things have. It had the qualities of its own inadequacies, you know. It had these qualities, and after a while, I came to appreciate it. It did me some good, you know. Then I was in an exhibition and I saw some paintings that hooked me up. I went back to look at them, and they were grey paintings, and they were filled with little figures. Little figures against little buildings, and the little buildings had chimneys and smoke, and I recognised that this was very similar to the world I'd come from. These were the paintings of Mr. L.S. Lowry, and I began to realise there were ways in which my own background could very surely be made into works of art.
On one hand, there was the bohemian world of Soho. On the other hand, there was the great images of these stoical and witty and stoical colliers that I knew. And I was pulled back and they proved stronger. These were the only people I knew. They were the kind of human beings that were in the public houses, in the reading room, in the chip shop queues. They were the people in the billiard halls. They were the only people I could draw. If I squeezed myself, they'd come out of me. One of the troubles about me and my world, the world I came back from London to build my life around working from in the way that Mr. Lowry had done, was that that world that I was reared in, was disappearing. The industrial world, the world of heavy industry, and the kind of human beings, the kind of stoicism, the kind of shapes that had come from these people, from the mean streets, from the backs, from the very hands that had been fashioned by the work they did, from the coal or the pot or the clay, these things were going. I have always been drawn to that which is poor, the richness of poverty, the grain of poverty. The grain of scrubbed wood, of things worn, of things that have achieved their shape through long, hard life. I watch them. I am fascinated by them. I am held by their shapes. I search into them and I look for them. And when I see any part of them that to me is perfect, it seems to be, oh, a certain kind of magnificence even. There's a richness here, and it's that kind of richness that I've been drawn to. I am drawn to that which is lumpen. Lumpen working class.
I was teaching in Burslem, which is Queen Street in Burslem, which is a street that runs right through my life. Queen Street is the street of my... it's a place that all my ambitions began there, and all my life seems to be, in a way, stuck there. Now, Burslem is a small town, not much bigger than two football pitches. And I was always taken by drink. And I think, in a way, you can only really get to Burslem. It's no use getting through it through manufacturers or shopkeepers or these damn things. You'll only get to Burslem through the public houses. That's where the working class of Burslem, and it's a totally working class town. The other people, they may give some talk about it, the felons, the gentlemen, but they don't live in Burslem. You've got to live in Burslem, in those streets, to understand and know what kind of a world it is. And in the 50s, when I was there, and I was born not far away, but in the 50s, in the public houses, if I should tell you the list of public houses, there was a Star, there was an Old Crown, there was a Queen's, there was a King's, there was a Duke, there was a Marquis, there was a White Swan, there was a Mitre, there was a Millstone, there was a Huntsman, there was a Stag, there was a Sea Lion, there was a Black Lion, there was a Red Lion, there was a Rose and Shamrock and the Thistle, there was an Albion, there was a Mason's Arms, there was a Blue Bell, there was a Durham Ox, there was a Foaming Quart, there was a Vine, there was a Railway, there was a Hole in the Wall, there was a Roebuck, there was an Old Vaults, a New Vaults, there was a Brewery, there was an American, and last but not least, there was a Jig Post. There were three big cinemas, there was a billiard hall, there were dance halls, the whole place. No place in England, no place in Europe in the size of 2 football pitches had got more. It was the best drinking town in England, bar none. I would go as far as say as in Europe. How the hell they all kept going, I don't, but they did. Down every little corridor in the public houses, in the smoke rooms, the back rooms, the snugs, they were all busy or going, people scraping whatever money you got. There was a dolphin too. Oh, good God. And I haven't finished there. There'd be more than that. You would wonder how they got them all in. No, certainly no place, no town I've ever known with so many in such a short place. It was a labyrinth of public houses and bars. There was a brewery, there was a bottling factory, there was a meat market, there were 2 town halls. You get that in a small town. It's, you can't match it. And all that was filled with life. All that was filled with colliers and bloody potters and labourers in white aprons and pot wenches covered in white dust and chimneys belching and the smell of aniseed and horse muck. What a town, what a place it was to be. You could, if you'd gone to Paris or Barcelona for a young artist, it couldn't have been more than that. That was a tremendous background. It had got a sky at night that turned to carmine from the great furnaces. It had got pitmen and colliers. It had got a great pit in the Sneed Dip. It with a Belgian. The Belgian was the dirt disposal machine at the top. It had got all sorts. It had got a ship in that at the back of the great tip. How can I say more than that? That's what it was to live among that. It had got a reading room where all the wrecks, it had got Vincent Riley, it had got Walsh's mate, it had, oh God almighty, it had got all the drinkers of all the meth. Down by the brick kilns they slept at night. It was like a Goya, like Goya's inside and against those furnaces at night with the derelict sleeping. All that it had got, and I was a young teacher then, scraping along on whatever few hours of teaching I could get a week.
All the students that were around him, they loved him. The boys and girls there, they all enjoyed being with him, because he never knew what he was going to do. He used to do these things when he'd come into the room, and he'd get his leg and put one leg on the floor and the other one on the table and pick himself up on the table and walk around the damn things. You'd never believe what he did. I mean, I think he enjoyed it. He was like, you know, he was like a child himself. But, you know, he was doing it for a reason in his mind, and at the same time he was doing some very, very good paintings.
And I can see him now, he'd use crayons, and the crayons were the kind that you'd buy for your child, you know, wax crayons, and he'd do it more often than not on board, and he put a piece of board up, and I remember he worked so vigorously, it used to flirt off the ears, it used to flirt, and he'd bend down, bang it, put it back on and scratch, you know, so vigorously with these. And I think he liked the crayon because it was immediate and he didn't have to fiddle about too much mixing oil paints, you know, it was direct and immediate. And I think that's why he used it so much.
His paintings were changing. They're becoming, his colouring was becoming more acute, because when I saw them, they were very dark. And, you know, the painter you just mentioned, he had copied those paintings because he was interested in them, because don't forget, we had no other way of doing it. Any road, he got into that, and then he started evolving his own system. And when I first met him, I mentioned these things to him, and he was quite interested in, he was on for a blooming half an hour telling me about these things, you know, and I was getting sort of flustered, you know, it was a bit much.
I could see it pictorially everywhere. I could see they'd made pictures. The way in which the town hall, the old town hall, is like a Peking. When you come up Newcastle Street, it looks like a building in Peking. And I mean, it's a massive, heavy block of a building. I should think a powerful Victorian building. When you think that in the Victorian time of fair poverty and difficulty, that town had enough vitality to put a building up like that. God, we couldn't do that now. And then some brains, they decided to knock the meat market down. They knocked the meat market down and made one or two lawns. Very fond of grass they are. Made one or two lawns there. The man that knocked the meat market down should have a ball and chain attached to his leg for the rest of his bloody life.
Homage to the oatcake. Let us pay homage to the oatcake, or oatcake, or woodcake, as the old men call them. The oatcake is not a cake at all, really. Not like the fairy cake or the Eccles cake. Not a cake in that way. More of a pottery's papadum, a sort of tunstall tortilla, a clay Suzette, as flat and thin as a dishcloth, and obedient and suppliant cheek that will bend any way you want it, round and floppy. The oat cake has a texture similar to the skins of old colliers or men dying of potter's rot. These are not cakes made for every day and should only be eaten twice or at the most three times a week, preferably at weekends when you are flush and filled with drink or the prospect of drink. Such richness every day would be too much, rather like having the news of the world delivered as a morning paper. There would surely be a drop in production and an explosion in the birth rate. No, oat cakes are best eaten at weekend, and all genuine oat cake shops are shut in the week, and their proprietors lie late abed and spend the rest of the day watching horse racing on the telly. I have heard it said that small fortunes are made in this trade, and among the pottery's working class, when a child is born, there can be no higher hope for it than it would become the proprietor of a damn good oat cake and pikelet shop. The pikelet, you ask? What's that? It's a sort of female oat cake, smaller, thicker, sweeter, more immediately seductive, sometimes with currants in it, a muffin for the lumpen working class, best eaten soaked in butter or marge. If overindulged in, both these oat cakes can play the very devil with your waistline. I must warn, indulgence leads to bulgence.
My mother, the strange thing about my mother and father, both of them were interested in the arts. And when they realised, and my mother in particular realised that I could do a little bit of something, she encouraged me. So that every night when I got home, and this applied to the others, she'd got different sort of books on the table. Now, that's yours because you haven't got, you're doing your maths, you're doing your English and so forth, and mine was about painting. And we all had to sort of read the chapters that she'd told us to read. And then we used to sit back on the settee and she'd ask us questions about what we'd read. And what did we think about, you know, the things that we'd read about in the book. And it was really a splendid way of understanding. Because, you see, my mother, when she was about, I was 18, she went to the Burslem Art College. And she really felt, it was in the evening, she went on the evening class because she got a job during the day. She was really keen, she wanted to follow it through. But she hadn't the money to go on. So she had to give that up, but she never gave up art. She used to bring books out from the library and look at the books and read them And then she used to write a lot about what she'd seen. Now, when I was growing up, all these things she used to show me and explain to me what art was about. And I really thrilled because she got a tremendous insight into these things. When my father said, did you know there was a chap called Arthur Berry that's teaching at Burslem? He says, because I know his father and mother. He said, would you like me to take you, you know, to Coppice Wood, so that you could actually, meet him in. But I mean, Arthur being what he was never where he was, he was all over the place. Any road we went up, and we had to get out because you had to walk quite a way and down into this little valley over this stream and then up, and their little house was there on the side. And of course, once my dad had knocked on the door, because he knew them, you see, her husband was a miner. And, they got loads to say. You know, it is. It's like you were in the background, they never think about you there. So I was like wandering round. So I said, is it all right if I go out and have a look round? She said, oh, you look round wherever you want, Enos. You know, so I went out. Well, there was this sort of wooden hut. I thought, well, that's strange. You know, it seems as though it's had something done to the doors and things like that. So anyhow, I went to the door and it was open, it wasn't shut. So I opened it up and I went inside. Well, the first thing I noticed was this bed. And on the bed were these bloody cans of paint. You know, when all the blankets and things were painted up to the hilt. And I thought, well, what's he been doing here? He can't be working in here, you know. So anyhow, when I'd finished, I went out and she asked me, she said, and what do you think, Enos, of where he lives? Oh, I said, I thought he lived with you. Oh, no, he doesn't live with me. He lives in that hut there. He's chosen to live in it, and that's where he's going to stay in it. He comes in here for his meals. Anyhow, so when we've been there for quite a long time, she says it doesn't look as though Arthur's going to come in. Is that he's talking to me dad? He said, I'll ring you up and let you know, because we didn't have a phone. So my dad says, well, what I'll do, I'll come over when I come off the bus at Biddulph, when I've been to work. He says, I'll come round and then you can tell me what's happened. And that's what he did. And Arthur had said, yes, of course you can come. And, I'll talk to your son and all this kind of stuff. And he did. We went round. And he was very nice to me, you know, and I always felt quite close to him.
Thank you.
students were the only reason why you go to an art college to teach. And I never bothered about what people had to say about me, because all as I wanted to do was to bring the student in and let them talk to me. And I would just, you know, give them a little bit of what I'd got to offer. And it worked so much better. I am not going to, you know, talk to them about, oh, I think you are this, that and the other and all that, because it doesn't work. It's the worst thing you can do, really. You've got to encourage them to do the things that they do well. And then out of that, they will discover what kind of an artist they are, and they'll begin to understand what art is about.